Once, they were the most feared of all of Megatron's soldiers. Now, the Permanent Revolution.
It always ends the same way. After the torture, I rouse them with a spot of music, and then whisper them to death. That's the routine. That's what people have come to expect. As Voss used to say, I miss his cynicism. The Empyrean Suite, the fourth movement. It's become our leitmotif, or as Helix calls it, our theme song. It's said to have been composed by Eucryphia to celebrate Prima's Citadel of Light. An ode to the Grand Duchies of Cybertron? A peon to the 13 tribes? Still, as Megatron once said to me, even the most debauched and fatuous society can, on occasion, produce something beautiful. Is it beautiful? I used to think so. These days, it barely registers. I've played it to death. Enjoying the music. Oh, Blip. A little propriety, please. Surely even the most boorish Decepticon knows that it's rude to talk with your mouth full. He is alive, Helix, which means you lost your bet. Put his brain back where you found it so he and I can chat. Impressive. Normally, if someone wakes up with his brain in his mouth and sees the people who put it there still standing in front of him, his first instinct is to start chewing. Now then, your Spark Eater cult. It's spectacularly at odds with Decepticon doctrine. Surely you know this. Surely this doesn't come as a surprise to you. Even someone with the most rudimentary grasp of Megatron's teachings must realize that a Decepticon utopia cannot accommodate any form of religion.
Why?
Why? Because religion is a form of control. It offers succor in return for docility and bestows power to an authority other than Megatron. So when a Decepticon starts a new religion, it's... well, you say it's an attempt at finding peace of mind. I say it's an attempted coup. Why did I do that? I shouldn't have done that. I shouldn't have mocked him. That was beneath me.
But I'm not a threat! This cult, it's just me! It's a cult of one!
And that, Blip, is how revolutions start. I wouldn't be wearing this mask were it not for a cult of one. A lowly miner who had a dangerous idea and clung to it. I'm going to tell the world that you used your last words to renounce your black-eyed fictive parasite god. But between you and me, because I do think we've established something of a rapport, is there anything you'd like to say before I kill you?
Too theatrical? Probably.
Take it off!
What?
Your mask! Take it off! Let me see you! You're a coward, Tarn! All you do is hide! Your real name? Your real face? What exactly are you hiding from?
He is not the first to catch me off guard, nor the first to ask me to remove my mask. I never respond, but today I come close. Today I nearly say, I don't wear this mask to hide my identity. I don't wear it to unsettle my victims, and I don't wear it in honor of our founder. I wear it for times like this, when I decide against talking someone to death. I wear it so that when I allow the others to have their way with you, and I give them free rein to indulge themselves, no one notices when I close my eyes.
The Peaceful Tyranny.
And we give thanks to our Lord and Founder, that his courage and wisdom may light the path towards everlasting peace and unrelenting tyranny.
Peace through tyranny.
And just what in the name of merry hell am I supposed to do with this? Look at him! Look at the state of him! How many times have I told you, when you're out hunting, make sure you...
Nicole.
Tarn, how many times? I can't recycle a transformation cog if it's all smooshed up.
Smooshed up?
Being a highly technical medical term that you've never heard of, because you're an unreconstructed killing machine.
Unreconstructed? I may be many things, but...
Enough. Just because I'm the size of an Energon cube doesn't mean I can't put you in your place. Him and you, Helix. Now open wide and say, I'm sorry I've been neglecting my oral hygiene. Filthy. Filthier than the inside of... By Prion Shadow, is that cranial fluid? It is! It's cranial fluid! You are officially worse than the pet. And don't think you're out of my bad books, Tess. When was the last time you sharpened these blades? Oh, I forgot. You're too cool to enunciate. Too cool and too frickin' lazy.
I swear she gets crosser every day.
She worries when we're in the field. Isn't that right, Nicole? You get angry because you care. Not precisely sure what she means by that gesture, but I imagine it tilts towards the obscene.
Disgusting! You fixed Decepticons with those hands?
And we seem to have the extended version of the first gesture. Goodness. Well, that really does leave no room for doubt.
Come on, new kids. My surgery. Proper checkups.
But we're fine.
Do as she says, Tesserus.
Tesk, health and safety gone mad.
Black mark.
All I said was...
Two black marks. One more and it's a written warning. You think we have a health and safety policy because it's fun? Which reminds me, appraisals, my quarters, soon as Nicole gives you the all clear. And this time, come prepared. Bring your PDPs.
Give me strength.
Tarn's quarters.
Innermost Energon?
No, thank you.
As you wish. It's a fine vintage, though. Rivets Field, first cycle 006. Tesserus. Sullen, capricious, ferociously violent, and right now, nervous as hell. He hates this. They all hate this. The self-assessment matrices, the competency frameworks, the balanced scorecards, this isn't what they signed up for. I won't drag this out. I'm largely happy with your performance. That's not to say there isn't room for improvement, but no, by and large, I'm satisfied. And yet I know that the Decepticon Empire will stand or fall on the strength of its internal administration. Megatron knows this too, for what is the Decepticon Justice Division if not a form of extreme performance management? I thought the manner in which you dispatched Borbit was particularly innovative, and you helped capture Heretech when he proved too much for Kaon, so... full marks on that.
Yeah, good, thanks.
Something's bothering you. Come on, you know these things shouldn't be left until your appraisal. I already know what he's going to say.
Voss and Kaon.
Voss and Kaon. 18 months ago, an undercover agent aboard an Autobot ship, the Lost Light, offered us an opportunity to take a name off the list. Overlord? Overlord's your prisoner?
More like an unwilling stowaway, but yeah, he's here, and I can prove it. I'll de-scramble his energy signature so you can pinpoint him. One proviso, when you come to collect, no one else gets hurt. I mean it, Tarn. If you attack the crew, you'll blow my cover. And believe me, I'm this close to the jackpot.
I had every intention of keeping my word. Until I saw who else was on the Lost Light. We were still buzzing from the nuke and running into deadlock, or drift as he'd taken to calling himself. Well, I think running into him served as something of a trigger. And once we'd killed one, it was hard to stop. Last month, at Nicol's insistence, we returned to Ofsted 17, to the murder scene. She couldn't believe we'd missed the opportunity to steal the Lost Light's quantum engines. We arrived to find the Galactic Council and the Black Bloc Consortia fighting over the same prize. We attacked, of course, I'd sooner die than allow organics to get their pudgy little hands on Cybertronian technology. Sadly, our intervention gave them a perfect excuse to join forces, and as Voss and Kaon chased a council squad to the planet below, the reinforcements showed up. 1,000 warships, maybe more. You're upset because we retreated, because we left Voss and Kaon behind.
Decepticons don't abandon their own. Don't you ever, ever tell me what Decepticons do and don't do. Understood?
I'll let it slide this time. As for your comrades, I've already given orders to collect their bodies.
Really?
2 hours ago, I told Helix to take us back to Ofsted 17 and...
Tarn! They're alive! They're okay! They're here!
What?
Voss and Kaon! I just teleported them on board!
That's... incredible.
That's nothing! Look at what they brought with them! You have to watch it!
Towards peace? Helix, I've read this 100,000 times. I've got the first edition mounted on my wall. I hardly think
I said watch it, not read it. There's some new footage at the end that you will not believe.
I am the founder of the Decepticon movement. I started it.
It's Megatron, Commander. He's defected.
Messatine.
I am the founder of the Decepticon movement. I started it, and I am about to finish it. I hereby renounce Decepticonism and its offshoots, and denounce all those who continue to fight in its name. There is nothing intrinsically special about our race. Nothing that lifts us above non-mechanical species. We were wrong to assert ourselves. And to all those who follow me, I say this. Do not expect guidance, or wisdom, or answers. I have none. I never did. To those Decepticons still out there, I give one final order. Stand down. Discard your weapons, tear off your badges, and stand down. The Decepticons are over. The war is over. Free yourself from the shackles of a flawed philosophy and move on.
Kaon, meet me in the fueling chamber.
2 miles below ground.
So this is it, the legendary nuke. Hate to say it, but your super fuel looks suspiciously like bog standard nucleon.
Careful. We don't have much left.
So grab a drill. We're standing in a nucleon mine, are we not? Nice to finally see the homestead, by the way.
This isn't nucleon. Not anymore. This is unique and finite. It seems the crystals in this mine, in this particular shaft, were once exposed to a burst of temporal energy. The energy, and for the life of me I can't replicate its baseline signature, acted as a slow-burning catalyst. Over the next few million years, it rewrote the crystal's atomic structure, turned them into something new.
Yeah, the ultimate performance enhancer. So how much of this stuff did you ship out to High Command?
None. Tarn refused to tell anyone except Megatron, and he was off-grid when we made the discovery. Where are you going?
Tarn's been in there ages. If this stuff is half as potent as you claim, ingesting too much of it could do serious damage.
Leave him. He knows what he's doing.
I know, and that's what worries me.
As my body surrenders to the pain, and as the pain becomes something more complicated, and as my sea-green spark begins to model and contract, I find myself looking backwards. And as I realize that this is it, that I'm about to die, I can't help but feel somewhat disappointed by the experience. But then again, what was I expecting? Music? A bright light? A vision? Change of plan.
I find it ironic that someone like Deathsaurus, someone famous for turning mud balls into pristine mini-Cybertrons, should take such poor care of his war world.
Except it's not his war world, is it? Not anymore. He stole it so he could go gallivanting around the Galactic Rim with his groupies.
I presume that's why we're here, Tarn. Level 5 infraction, aggravated theft, that's what it says on the list. Speaking of which, I notice we seem to have skipped a few names. Are we not killing people in order anymore?
Life signs. 500? That's a lot more than I was expecting.
Good.
500? Sounds more like 5,000. Talk about chat. This is why Interdecepticon Radio is always a bad idea. It relies on an insecure frequency, and it encourages inane conversation.
What's today's topic? Let me guess. How they turned their back on the cause when their beloved leader was refused a promotion?
Is that why Death saw a split?
I honestly don't know. He's always been something of a mercurial character. He probably had a dozen reasons for leaving, all of them irrational.
Okay, Rekkaek overcloaked or not, I don't like being this close. One slip and he'll detect us.
Detect us? He's expecting us. This isn't a raid, Helix. It's a rendezvous.
I'm sorry, Commander. I told him you were busy, but he insisted on seeing you now.
Don't apologize, Bacchus. Tarn is a voracious consumer. Music, Energon, T-Cogs. But he's never had much of an appetite for waiting. You'll have to bear with me. We're in the middle of upgrading the hyperdrive. You know how it is. Places to go, planets to ransack. You could always help. I know you like to get your hands dirty. I thought you'd be wearing an Autobot mask. I thought you'd be running around the galaxy apologizing to everyone on Megatron's behalf. About that, we need to speak in private. You see, I'd love to, I really would, but we operate a strict no-secrets policy. Please, don't make me force the issue. Actually, Tarn, would you mind taking a couple of steps backwards? And a few more steps? That's all. Just to be on the safe side. You see, I'm worried I may have miscalculated the blast radius. A rendezvous, please. When a fanatic famous for killing with his voice says he wants to drop by for a quiet word, it's hard not to jump to conclusions. It's at times like these that I regret my reputation as a smooth talker. I was born with a deadly gift, albeit one that was slow to manifest itself, but sometimes I wish it didn't define me. Warning shot. Do you know how many of my troops you've slaughtered over the years? How many good Decepticons you've picked off just because they stood by me? We should intervene.
Boss is right. He wouldn't thank us.
Okay, but just so we know, if this goes wrong, I put the suggestion out there.
Be reasonable, Deathsaurus. All I want is the opportunity to explain myself.
You know, this weaponized conversation shtick is getting pretty old. All I have to do is shut down my audio sensors, and there we go. I've just put you on mute.
Are you sure?
What? How are you doing that?
Interdecepticon Radio. I told Kaon to hijack the frequency before we came on board. I can talk to all your troops at once. Now, is everyone listening? Or do I have to lower my voice? Question, when did you become a Decepticon?
I was built a Decepticon.
As I thought. You weren't there at the beginning. You weren't there to watch the Decepticons grow, from an idea to an army. Victory by victory, Deathsaurus. That's what it was back then. Victory after victory. Megatron was... Oh, he was magnificent. Overthrowing the Senate, emancipating the manual classes, nothing was beyond him. True, Prime's Autobots proved something of an impediment, but by and large he achieved his aims. And only then did he allow himself to look upwards, to consider his place, our place, in the wider universe. He realized that the prejudice and injustice he'd rallied against on Cybertron was prevalent elsewhere, everywhere in fact. The universe was actively and implacably anti-mechanical. Of the flesh, for the flesh. It didn't take him long to identify tens of thousands of organic races that had the potential to do us harm. He saw it as his duty to strike the first blow. The alternative was to do nothing and invite attack. In moving to protect the organics, the Autobots were motivated entirely by a desire to put an upstart miner back in his place. Had they not interfered, Megatron would long ago have resolved the tension between organic and inorganic races by removing all trace of the former. And that, Devsaurus, is the Decepticon cause. The ongoing struggle to eliminate every threat to Cybertronian happiness and prosperity, whether that threat is foreign or domestic.
I thought you played your victims' music, not gave them history lessons, unnecessary ones at that. Where's this all going?
Somewhere along the way, I allowed myself to think that Megatron was bigger than the Decepticon cause. When I learned that he'd defected, I was ready to give up. I was a fool. No one is bigger than the Decepticon cause. True, Megatron was the first to articulate it, but it lives on without him. It sings. It soars. And it took someone hearing it for the first time to remind me of how beautiful it sounded. This is Nicol. She's our newest recruit, and the last of her kind.
How so?
She's a colonist, one of thousands born of Prion. A Titan who left Cybertron during ancient times. We found her days after an attack that wiped out her colony.
An attack? The Autobots wouldn't.
The Autobots didn't. It was the Black Bloc Consortia. They know we're vulnerable, Devsaurus. The Consortia and the Galactic Council. They know our race is reduced and scattered, and they're committed to finishing what their ancestors started. They want to annihilate us.
And in response, what? What exactly are you advocating?
We do as Megatron did. We fight.
We?
Join us. Join us, and I'll take you off the list. All is forgiven.
I'd want my troops cleared as well. If I join you, they join you, and everyone's slate is wiped clean.
Yes. Yes, that was always my intention.
In that case, I have one further condition. But first, you need to disengage from the network.
Well,
what's this condition? Kill your team. You murdered dozens of my troops. Seeing the rest of your Justice Division die by your hand would go some way towards making amends.
I find it surprisingly easy to say, no, no, the answer's no.
Then we have a deal. But I needed to get the measure of you, Tarn. I could never throw my weight behind a leader who treated his soldiers like fodder. That's why Megatron and I parted company. So what now? There's a Galactic Council facility in the neighboring sector. Once we're mobile, we could fire up the Star Blasters and pay them a visit. For a second, I wonder what Megatron would want us to do. And then I remember, everything's changed. The Decepticon Empire will stand or fall on the strength of its internal administration. Before we attack the organics, there is some housekeeping to attend to. By his actions, Megatron has put himself on the list. In fact, as of right now, he is the list. What's more, if the end of Tort's peace is to be believed, he somehow managed to ally himself with a ship full of Autobots I thought we'd eliminated. Before we do anything else, we're going to find them, all of them, and we're going to kill them, properly this time. So gather your troops, charge your weapons, and let us repair the peaceful tyranny. Indeed. Let battle be joined, eh? Oh, this is more than battle, Devsaurus. We're going to war.
Coming soon, The Dying of the Light.